Hi Lee, my name is David Kwan. I'm responding to the video that you posted yesterday on May 4, 2013. The video is titled Prisoners in Jail Posting Videos on Facebook. Now, I realize that you'll probably never, you know, watch this video or never even care to, because I realize I'm a tiny little plankton in the YouTube ocean. So I'm a very little guy, and I barely get any views or whatever. But I just thought it was such an interesting topic that I would like to make a vlog about it and just talk about it. I learned about this scenario through your video, so I thought to mention you. Whether you watch it or not, whether you accept this video as a response to your video or not, approve it or not, you know, I mean, that'd be cool if it happened, but I realize that the chances are pretty slim, knowing that, you know, my status on the YouTube world is pretty low. So that said, that's one disclaimer. The second disclaimer I would like to kind of point out is that, like you, I have not personally been to a prison. I've never been inside a prison, I've never visited a prison, and really, I don't really have like personal experience with how that works, how it looks like. I think I've been to a courthouse once, but that's pretty much it. So personal experience-wise, I don't know how prisons function or how prisons look like. All my accounts pretty much come from reading and also from secondhand accounts. What I mean by that is I majored in social work. I have a bachelor's degree in social work. And what that kind of attaining that enabled me to have a bunch of different opportunities, internships, volunteer experiences, and job experiences in which I met a lot of people who were in prison or who work in prison. When I was a college freshman, I believe, I talked with someone who works as a warden in a prison. Also, in my, you know, work experience, volunteer experience, I came across a lot of different kinds of people, homeless people, because I did work at a homeless shelter at one point. But I met a lot of people who would be considered ex-convicts. A lot of the people that I met who served their terms in prison or who was returned back to prison, most of the people I met were for what I would consider as like non-serious crimes. Most of them, as you would expect, for drug possession or drug dealing. Most of them those are non-violent crimes, which I would consider as non-serious crimes. Most of them are of that category. A great percentage I met were sex offenders, you know, abusers of domestic violence, and you know, of I guess sexual molestation and great deal of sexual offenders, all of that. I think very minority of the people I talked to served their prison, you know, were convicted of a crime like murder. I did meet some of those people, and they did tell me their life experiences. They didn't tell me the detail of how they ended up committing the crime, but I have met murderers in my life and have talked to them. That's my point. And they have served prison sentences and whatnot from where I met. And some had committed robberies and thefts and all that. The reason I bring all this up is not only to, you know, to recognize that I have my own bias and my own limited knowledge, but also to tell you that I think the assumptions you make in your video are really big assumptions, really broad, generalized assumptions. First of all, let's look at the title of the video. Prisoners in Jail Posting Videos on Facebook. Now, I know the term jail is often used interchangeably with the word prison or correctional facility. But technically, jail, prison, correctional facility may not necessarily mean the same exact place. Because crimes, you know, the severity of the crime can vary depending on the person who committed that crime. I mentioned non-serious crime, like non-violent crime, such as drug possession. We don't punish someone who possessed marijuana the same way we punish a murderer with premeditated intent. Two different kinds of crimes, different severity. We put them in different kinds of facilities, and we punish them differently. But anyway, I just wanted to throw that out there. The central theme in your video I see is this notion that once you're convicted and you're sent to prison, you should be punished accordingly, and that punishment should be as unpleasant as possible. That seems to be the central notion in your video. For the most part, it's a notion I don't disagree with entirely, but at the same time, I mention all those nuances there so that, you know, it's not as simple a picture as that. This example of prisoners posting videos on Facebook, you automatically assume that it means that taxpayers' money is being used for prisoners to use the internet. That may not necessarily be the case. See, we live in an age where a smartphone can use the internet now. And of course, a prisoner having a phone would definitely be illegal, but it does pass through. Some people, especially in correctional facility where the security is more lax, because you know there are different kinds of correctional facilities, as I mentioned. Some are for serious offenders, rapists, murderers, those things. And let's not even consider Guantanamo Bay, which is a whole totally different political prisoner situation altogether. But we have those facilities, and we have these kind of facilities where, you know, either it's juvenile detention centers or for, you know, marijuana possession, sex offenders. Different kinds of facilities have different kinds of security rules. I'm imagining these low, you know, this is my speculation now, so this may not be the case, but you've never even considered this in your video, so I'm bringing this scenario up. The scenario where it's a very low security correctional facility. This prisoner has family members visit him, the family members slip him a phone, and with that phone he's able to access the internet and use Facebook. Did that involve any taxpayer money at all? No, it didn't. Should the enforcement of something like, the fact that prisoners should not be able to have access to phones, should that be enforced and implemented? Yeah, definitely. But I think it's weird that you have this, you know, this notion that prison system is kind of falling by the wayside, that people are, you know, going to commit crimes because they think, you know, prison is pleasant and happy. Most people who, from whom I met, who came out of prison, do not want to go back to prison. And those are including people who recently came out. I've communicated with people who recently came out of prison and right into the homeless shelter that I was working in. They do not want to go back to prison, okay? No one I've met in my life want to go back to prison. You know, it has TB, maybe they can get internet access, whatever, but it's still very, very unpleasant that they do not want to go back to prison. Now, there is such thing as institutionalization, I forget the term, but people who are so used, people who spend years and years and years in prison, that once they get out, they can't socialize, they can't handle being outside of prison. Those people, I guess, some of them, some percentage of them would commit a crime to be able to go back to prison. A lot of them commit suicide or try to, because, you know, they don't want to go back to prison, but they don't want to live in this world. So that's kind of the thing that happens with them. All right. So that's my whole thoughts on my comments on that. I hope I was, you know, eloquent enough for that. The last question you pose is workout facilities, which you don't think they should exist at all in prison, Lee. That's an interesting opinion, I think. In some ways, I agree with you that allowing, you know, prisoners, convicts, whatever, these facilities in order to build up their muscles does make them, in a sense, more dangerous because they become more powerful through the workout. But I think the counterpoint I can offer is they are kind of necessary because they give prisoners something to do with their idle time at times. I think this is really necessary because it allows them to use their pent up anger and frustration on something. So they're not just being idle and just being bored, and that causes person to just go insane. Any person who doesn't even commit a violent crime, you put them in a cell with nothing to do and just make their life miserable for years, that person is going to come out of prison an insanely dangerous man, simply because that's what you subjected him to. So I do agree that workout facilities can, in a way, be more dangerous. But it's like having, letting them play basketball, letting them read books. I guess workout facilities, in a way, it does raise a little alarm bell about danger issue but here and there. But it's not like workout facilities come equipped with karate instructors or boxing bags. If there are boxing bags, they totally shouldn't be there. These are not a fighting room, training rooms. They're just workout facilities. And it allows them to, the pent-up anger and frustration and depression they have, allows them to kind of let that go, release that. I think that's one major proponent of it. Whether they should be completely removed or not, I don't have a strong opinion on either side, but I just wanted to kind of bring that argument in there. I do really think that more than just treating, a prison sentence as a punishment, we also do have to worry about the fact that a lot of these prisoners are going to come back into society. Hardly any crime they commit is for life, and some crimes should be for life, but most are not. They will come back to society. We have to prepare for that, and that's why we have prison social workers, prison psychiatrists, psychologists, and things of that nature, to make sure they come out not more horrible than they were put in. Those are my, thoughts on this. I hope, this gets approved to be your video response on your video, but if not, I totally understand. I'm a really, like I said, I like this metaphor. I'm a tiny little plankton in the YouTube ocean. But yeah, that's my video response to you. Hope you enjoyed it. Cheers.